Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Goedenavond, dames en heren. Welcome to another episode of Cape Fred Stories. We have a very interesting topic tonight, something that I want you guys to participate in. I've got a few gentlemen with me in the studio. We want to talk about apartheid economy. If that still exists, is it a myth or is it real? That is a debate that we can have tonight. Is apartheid economy still real? Is it still, does it still exist? It's something people will say, yeah, but you're talking nonsense. But I feel that we're not really being open here. We're not really being honest with one another. So I'm going to invite the gentleman into the studio with me. I've got Wafik from Strandfontein. Good evening, Wafik. Welcome to Cape Flat Stories. Jesse, good evening. And then we have also the other gentleman that will join us now. Wafik, how are you, sir?
I'm fine, thank you, Stan. Good to be in your program.
Thank you, man. I always wanted you on. It was always long with you. Ladies and gentlemen, this is Mr. Preston. Welcome, Preston. Welcome to Cape Fred Stories. Many of you might know him. He's very popular promoting small businesses. So, Preston, just tell us more about yourself.
Hi, guys. I'm Preston. Also known on TikTok as Resistance 89. For promoting small businesses, especially in Strandfontein local businesses, I feel that I lose out nothing if I promote the next man to move forward in life.
Awesome. Thank you for joining us, and we will talk more to Preston. I'm going to just open up and speak and allow yourself, Wafik, just to maybe share what is your knowledge on this topic. What is apartheid economy? Is there something like that? Some people told me I'm talking nonsense. I'm using my influence for nonsense. But I want to hear from you, and I want random guys to talk about this. What is apartheid economy?
Okay, from what I understand, right? If you look at the apartheid era, right? The stuff that happened to us, I would say the non-whites back then, right? Where we were sidelined, for a number of things, right? We weren't given the opportunities that. I would say the whites got back then, right? I'm sure if our forefathers and grandfathers had, and our fathers had the opportunities, I'm sure they would have been quite far in life today. You know, unfortunately, it has carried over into our society today, whereas just a few people are benefiting from the capital that's left in the country at the moment. Unfortunately, it's quite serious. It's just us colored people and the Indian people are always left in that middle to fight and to get what we want in life. You know, we haven't been given, even up till today, we haven't been given that opportunities to shine. Why? Because it's been taken away. The white man had it before, now the power that has got that power, and they're milking this country for everything it's worth, you know. And then our colored people are suffering, our Indian people are suffering. So where does it leave all of us as well? You know, even some of the black people are still suffering because their own people that's in government is actually using them for votes only and not even helping them. I mean, we've seen it around us as well. You know, we live in this in the society where, you know, we don't get the opportunity that we need. Why? Because given to the majority of the people. So yeah. So I think it still exists.
And you think it's still very much alive? I have heard some things where people, you know, also from other angle. Remember also with the apartheid economy, with the apartheid government, a lot of international companies didn't invest into South Africa for the mere fact that apartheid was still very much alive. It was a segregation between different, you know, race of people. I feel the economy in Cape Town, let's talk about Cape Town. I feel that is a big problem where many of the small businesses don't really get funding from
correct
government, from local businesses, from the investors. I feel that the investments are still being kept away from our people on the Cape Flats. There's many.
Can I just say something? Sorry, Stan.
Yeah.
Can I just share something, right? We have a project coming up, right? Resurfacing of the road, right? I think it's, if you look at the both amounts is the value of 17 million rand just to resurface two parts of the road, right? Now, the contractor that's got it is benefiting quite a lot. And from what I've heard, I mean, I've never heard, from his own mouth, he said he's only taking five laborers from our communities. And that's laborers, not general workers, which is laborers. Where's our artisans? Where's our skilled labor? They're not even doing that. So yes, it is still alive. I mean, I'm witnessing it today.
We are off air now. We've just lost. There we go. We're back. All right. So sorry about that. We just had some connectivity issues. Uncle Abu also joined us now. I'm just gonna ask him to come sit on the side. We are very much what you've mentioned now. I think small businesses and our local people are not really being looked at, and there is a thing going around saying that we are not compliant. I think we are compliant. If you look at our people, and if we are not compliant, why don't we assist our people to become compliant? We can't say that we are not compliant. We need to find a way to help our people to become compliant. And I think that is the big issue that I have here. Let me just make this bigger. Sorry, guys, man, we're just a bit timakaya. There we go. So, Uncle Abu, welcome to Cape Flow Stories. It's a topic that myself and you spoke briefly about Saturday. What is your view on apartheid economy?
On apartheid, well, it exists. First of all, it exists is that there's no bond.
Mm-hmm.
First of all, between our people and we're not using those phrases again, like colors and whites and blacks. Let's put that aside.
Mm-hmm.
But before we put it aside, let's talk about us as a colored community.
Mm-hmm.
We have major issues because we're not supporting each other first and foremost.
Yeah.
Once we have that connected, and we establish ourselves as helping each other, we can start venturing up.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because we have a lot of talent. It's basically like, I mean, I went to UCT, I studied the theory of things, and I look at it like, hey, they put us there to study those things. Then still people don't have any job, and you know, most of the colored people are very skillful in bricklaying, spray painting, and music, you name it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so why do we have to do that and not create work for ourselves?
Mm-hmm.
You know. Where the apartheid is concerned is the small businesses are suffering because the big businesses, they just cater for themselves.
That's right.
But work hand in hand. If small businesses, they help each other, and the big businesses, they come on board,
mm-hmm.
and they can exchange ideas and work together,
mm-hmm.
you know.
Mm-hmm. That can.
Yeah, I just feel why I say economic apartheid, because that is what's basically happening. You can see it. It's visible.
Yeah.
You know, it's logic and it's visible. So right. Anyone say this? No, it's not there.
It is there.
It is there.
It is there. Jovan, on your side, your thoughts on this. Yeah. I mean, you are in business. You know what it is like for certain people. They are compliant. You get people compliant. I think that's part of your job.
Yeah.
You get people compliant. But when you look at colored businesses, small colored businesses, it obviously they are compliant, but they still don't qualify or don't meet certain criteria. Just more on your side, you know. On this topic,
I think the one of the big things, and this is something I chatted to a few people about also, is the system that was put in place.
Mm-hmm.
So that system worked for how many years?
Mm-hmm.
They built it up for themselves. They built up 20, 30 years of a system.
That's good.
That system became a beast. It's very hard for us to pull out of that system.
Yeah,
because of our mindset being brainwashed.
And also because the money is in that system. So the moment I pull out or say, you know what, no man, I'm actually not just a worker, I can actually own a business. The system works in such a way where, you know, we went to school, we had to go study, so we can get a good job, we can buy a house, we can get married, we can have children, retire, that's it. How many businessmen do you know retires?
Exactly. Exactly.
They're 80, they're still running the company, they're still overseeing it, they haven't retired. They're playing golf, it doesn't mean they're retired. So the system has been put in place for so many years, they build up and build the wealth that is just going from generation to generation. How long is it going to take us to get that type of wealth? Because we weren't handed this on a plate. So this wealth is set up like this for the billions and billions and billions and billions.
That's correct.
So then they say, no, no, you must go and work. I'm saying, no, let's create an entrepreneurial culture between the next generation so that we can build up wealth. We can build up generational wealth so that our great-grandchildren can sit with billions. But I mean, it's going to take years.
Yeah,
it's not something that's just like, okay, because the system was built for them.
Also the, just one. Wait for 24 years. I don't know what's going on. I had to adapt to a lot of things. I opened my own company.
Yeah.
And my wife, she said to me, hey, I have to be the boss. I said, why do you have that? She says, no, because the women has power here. Okay, fine. In Islam also, the women is power, but the man is able. I'm okay about that. But then she said, but we have to have black people. I said, hey, well, we have to have black people in the company. If it's come to work, I said, I've got no problem with that. If you can do the job, yeah, better than the next person, if it's whether it's white or colored, Indian or Chinese, I don't care. If he's a good entertainment manager, I said, no, it doesn't work like that. You must. I said, no, man. So that, so she told me it's BBE, whatever this thing is.
Yeah.
I'm like, I'm not happy with that thing. Because at the end, I said, okay, if it's black, fine, then I can have my... said, no, you are colored. I'm like, and she works on high levels, you know. Says, so doesn't color go with the... with the, no? I said, well, what if I... Let's say I would stand to be my entertainment manager. And I want you... you no, it must be black. But we are not black.
Yeah, so that will qualify.
So that means we still have racism in our country.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the way I look at it. You know, maybe you guys can tell me if I'm wrong.
I think to come back there, well, one of the things also, another economic challenge is the BEE status. A lot of people are saying, yes, we are, we qualify as BEE candidates. We have been, you know, but once you go for a job, we have been previously disadvantaged. But when you apply for a job and it's you against another black man, they're going to say, but that black man was, he was worse off than what you were. There's no such thing as worse off. We were also, we went through the same.
Yeah.
There's nothing different to what the black man did and what the colored man did. We all went through, we all were disadvantaged. And I think that is the big problem that we have, is that in this country, when it comes to BEE, we shouldn't have people get into a position because of the color, but because of merit. I think that is another challenge, is that we can't do the job. We have a job, but we can't do the job because we're not qualified. I can become a music director, a music manager, because of my skin color. But like Abu can't, because he is lighter than me. But like Abu has years of experience. What, which one works better? The one with the experience, the one with the management skills. So I think that is the problem. Also, you touched on a very important point, Jovan, just now, when you said that advantages has been taken away from us. Now just think about it. We didn't have to buy property if our parents still lived in Constantia, if our parents still lived in District 6, in Musenberg. We didn't have to buy property if our parents still owned that property. We would have lived on our generational wealth now. We would have extended the houses. We would have lived there. You wouldn't have had a bond. You wouldn't have had a bond. I wouldn't have had a bond. 20 years of sacrificing to a bank. Now, you must also remember the other thing. You pay a bond over 20 years. I said this previously, and I'll say it again, in this evidence to prove that you guys need to just do your homework. When a colored man goes to the bank for a loan, he pays much more interest than the white man, even the black man as well.
Yeah.
The infrastructure, the word apartheid is gone. It is gone. But the infrastructure is still very much erected and still standing there. We're operating in a system that previously disadvantages us and still do so today. So my argument tonight is, it's very simple. My argument tonight is, are we being treated fair as colored people? Are we being treated fair as people of the soil? Because we are people of the soil. We were born here. They found us here. Like I said earlier on, our fathers and uncles were still very much employed many years ago. After the new BE thing, we didn't went backwards. Our fathers aren't working, our uncles aren't working. We can't find jobs because we're colored. We are really being marginalized here. But I would like to hear more about my guest. Wafik, what is your view on that answer?
Sure. You know, to be honest, like before, we've been disadvantaged. Again, we've been disadvantaged. We've been sidelined for everything that happens. If we look at every city project that ever happens, who's getting those main contracts? Who's getting those tenders? With the BE also, for me, BE, I mean, I'm also black. I'm a South African, proudly South African. But I can't even get half the jobs that the black man can get today. It was same in apartheid. The white man got the top jobs. Today, whether you have education, whether you have experience, it doesn't count for you. It counts against you because you're not black enough to get that job. So where do you stand? Like I said, there's so many tenders that come out. Who's getting these tenders? Are they actually qualified to actually do those tenders? Or is it someone's friend that sits up there that's actually getting those tenders? So we need to ask ourselves, what are we doing wrong? And the answer is, we're doing nothing wrong. We qualify everything. I mean, I've also got a business as well. My business is registered. I've got all my documentation. Everything is 100% accredited, right? But then you go apply for a tender. You don't get it. Why? Because that tender is already allocated for somebody else. They're only putting out the tender just to blindside us, that they're putting out a tender. But they know already that tender is already tendered for somebody else. So where do you stand? You actually can't get anything. So, I mean, even if you've got all the documentation, they only do it to tick a box. Well, we put out the tender, we tick that box, but hope my cousin can do a bit. My cousin can do it, and I can score about 5 million from it. Mm. So by the time it gets to the small guy like us, or the small business, what is a small business making out of that contract? 10-20,000 rand. Yet the contract was worth 10-15 million rand. So who's got that money?
And that's big money, eh? That's really big money. If you think about it, all the contracts that these guys gain through these tenders, it's big, it's millions. And unfortunately, their families, their wealth has been built for the next generations. We are still sitting here. We're still trying to buy electricity. We're still trying to pay petrol money, to pay our bonds, while everybody else are benefiting. I just want to hear from Jovan quickly and from Preston. You guys as young guys, look, I'm a few years older than you. Uncle is a few years older than myself. But I want to hear from you guys. In this day and age, how is it for you guys to start your own? I know you're a businessman. In yourself, how difficult is it for you guys to start your own businesses? And I mean, there's many other young people like yourself out there as well.
It's at this point, starting your own business, you have to look at another successful person and steal with your eye and create your own opportunities. It's really hard to just open up a business and not know how to market yourself, because at the end of the day, the person is buying into you as an individual. But now a lot of our brothers and sisters are not educated in that. And what we are trying to do, we're trying to market that way. We can assist you, show you how to sell yourself, basically. But I am telling you the truth, it's hard to start a business. And if you don't have a vision or any goals, you're going to fail. Because it's a large percentage. I'm not sure what's the percentage of businesses that in the first 2 years?
Yeah, first year already.
In the first year, businesses fail. So thank you, Lord, for having my business up until now. And you guys will soon see something big happening.
Inshallah, inshallah.
I think it's also something that you I think I must mute.
That's fine.
Okay. I think it's also something like we weren't trained to run businesses. We were trained to work.
Mm-hmm.
You were trained to work for somebody. You weren't trained and prepared to take on the risk. You weren't trained about investments. You weren't trained on how to manage money. You weren't do a lot of things. You weren't trained to do. You know what I mean? Like we weren't. When I was at school, they didn't say go and start a business. They said, what are you going to go study so that you can get a good job? Yeah. They didn't train you what you can do with the pocket money, start a business, start that type of thing when you are 16, so that when you are 18, you are ready to go and pay for your own studies. Because I had friends that paid for their own studies.
Because the money was already working for
because
them.
Because they were sorted. But also they had compound wealth. Their grandfather lived like, I drove through town one day and I asked my wife this question. I said, who owns these buildings? And I asked now, who owns these buildings? I said, because they are selling these buildings for 420 million. This buildings was built when? By the great grandfather.
Mm.
It was then given to the son. The son gave it to the grandchild. He's 940 million.
He's just sowing suddenly into this 140 more.
Because of compound wealth, because of generational wealth that was given over. And where did it come from? That's the question we must ask. Because we weren't trained to own our own buildings. We wouldn't say, Preston, you can have your own building one day. You can go and have your own. This was something that you had been given. And if these generations that are well off now, it's because their fathers had to hustle.
Yeah, they had to hustle. It's crazy how far behind we are and how much we need to catch up in order to be on par with a person that has got the generational wealth thing going for them and the compound.
No, I'll just say something. And I mentioned to myself, why I'm the one who said economic about it. That's one of the reasons. So basically what happened, each and every person has a choice.
Mm-hmm.
You work for a company, or you have your own business.
Yeah.
So you have a choice. If you want to have an easy life, let's say I'm a printer. I work in a printing company.
Mm.
I'm an employee for the employer. It's his business, right? So I work from this time to that time, I clock out. But my other choice is, now I want to take that risk. I want to start my own business. I want to have my own things. It's easy. Why is it easy? Because you made the choice. So if you made the choice to take that risk, you're going to be successful. But with economic apartheid, it's impossible. Because you see what happened? Why do we still talk about color today? We don't mean it.
Mm.
We don't want to talk about it.
Mm.
But why are we still talking about it? Why are we still talking about color and black and white?
Mm.
Because there's economic apartheid. Because when it was political apartheid, we talked about color. Now that's erased. So now we have economic apartheid.
It's not supposed to be there.
So if it is equality in economy, then no one's going to talk about color.
Mm.
Chinese, Indian. If it's an Indian guy working for me, no one's going to say he's Indian. They're going to say he's my music director. No one's going to say Indian because it's equality. Because he's doing a great job. But because of the inequalities, and the apartheid in economics creates that. So basically, we're still talking about race because we have no equality in our economy system.
Mm. Mm.
The playing field is still very much uneven. That is what you're saying.
Yeah.
Many people are saying, yes, like I read Jesse's message here. Herman Masaba became a multimillionaire during apartheid. Businesses know no color. Investors just want strength and profits. I'm going to disagree with you on that. You must remember, and this is something that Douglas also mentioned the other day, what's his name? Gaitan also said, how many Gaitans are there? There's not a lot of them. There's not a lot of millionaires when it comes to color people. You must remember, there's a Gaitan McKenzie, there's a Patrice Motsepe, there's maybe a Herman Masaba, right? That is three guys out of a lot of people. Remember, we are the majority, right? But we own the minority of business. So now the system has been tweaked. And we can disagree with me, it's fine. It's my mindset. It is what I've picked up over the years. My debates is from my knowledge that I've experienced, how the way I see it, are very practical. So many people are saying, yeah, but now, why is this? There needs to be, they need to show the world, okay, there's also colored people and black people that's, you know, making it out there, the businesses. So they really don't look, like I said, so that businesses overseas can still invest into the country. You must remember, if you look at Cape Town, who owns 90% of those businesses? Not us. If our business people wants money from government, and this we have established recently, if our government, if our business owners, our colored business brothers and Indian business brothers want businesses in the textile industry, they need to have a contract with the big corporate companies. Now, those guys, now remember, I said this on this platform a while back. There's people out there that have their own CMTs. They make dresses for the big companies. Let's say there's a designer warehouse. I'm not going to mention names. That designer warehouse sells a dress for 3,000 rand. The CMT in Hanover Park, in Manenberg, in Bondi, well, that aunties are working their fingers off. They get for a dress 350 rand, while it sells for, let's say, 3,000 rand. From that 350, the lady in charge needs to pay each and everybody working for her, buy electricity and all those things. At the end of the day, they get a small amount of money. But they have to work, because if they don't work, they can't feed their family. Yeah. Our people know, like, if I don't work, I can't pay my bond, and if the gentleman here do. So we are desperate for work, because what has happened in this country also, the employment rate has dropped, so there's more unemployed youth and people in Cape Town, in South Africa. So what are you going to do? Any job that comes along, you're going to take. And businesses know there is a hard, you know, there's no jobs, so now they're also going to treat you as if you were no one. So I don't know. That is my opinion. This is how I feel. I'll give a bit of time to Wafik. Maybe he can see what is more light on this one.
Stan, to be honest, you know, you're quite bright, you know, and the sad part is the businesses that employ you today pay you next to nothing. Next to nothing. You're lucky to get 100 rand a day because they know you're desperate for a job. And for me, that is right. No matter what education, I mean, say I finish university, right? I'm looking for a job. And I get a job at a accountant company. The salary they start you off is less than what the next person would have gotten if you were a different color also. We need to understand that, right? I've seen it in the place, the work, places that I've been at as well, right? Is that I've been there for so many years, right? Right, and my salary will remain at that, but you get a guy that is slightly, I would say, light colored, right? Meaning white, gets into the job, straight out of university, earning 2-3 times more than what I'm getting, but yet I had to train that person in that field. So basically they know I'm desperate for that job. But because I'm not of color that they're looking for, so they can pay me anything they want to. And I must be happy with it. So I think I spoke to you on Saturday. If we do not stand up as colored people and fight these injustice that's keep on happening to us from apartheid till now, it's not going to change. But also in the same breath, we need to stand together. The problem is also with us, we get too comfortable in our surroundings. We say, "Ah, just leave it, it's fine." But it's not fine. It is not fine. Because remember, we're paving a way for our kids to take over. What are they going to take over from us if we don't make a stand today? So yeah, we need to stand up.
But that is what you're right about. And we spoke about it. If we're not going to stand up, this is not things that people want to talk about. Because, you know, this now, we are touching another level of questions. Because people are saying, you are troublemakers. We're not troublemakers. We're just opening up. What is the problem?
People run away from things. Same like load shedding, I've noticed.
Yeah.
Load shedding. It's dangerous, man. Load shedding is... People get used to it.
Yeah.
The problem with our people, we get used to things, man. If there's shooting guns in the street here.
Yeah.
Before they had Pagan, remember?
Yeah.
And they were solving things and now the people are used, they don't care anymore. It's like that's right.
Yeah.
It's normal. Everything is normal.
They're both like resistance. Must stop
accepting things, man. And start facing things, face reality. Don't run away from it, man.
Yeah.
Because our people, we run away all the time.
That's right.
For what you're running away? Stand your man, man.
Yeah. and the nice thing is this, uncle, if we stand together, like there's four of us here, right? If we start standing together and saying, hey, but we're fighting for the same thing, man. There's four of us. But if I'm going to do it alone, or there's five of us, if I'm going to do it alone, or you're going to do it alone, then we don't have unity. We need to look at how can we get our people together. Like, our biggest problem is, at the moment, the economy, the way the climate can change. But you know, and I know, we don't support local people. Mm-hmm. That's another mindset that says, we know we're struggling financially on the Cape Flats. We know we're struggling our businesses. But we are going to go tomorrow and we're going to go buy our food and clothing in town where the money's going to stay. We're not really getting the money into our community, into our economy. How do we kickstart our economy? We still kickstart our economy by supporting our own people, buying consistent from the auntie and steamboat road, buying, going to the event, it was your Saturday, buying from the people. And then we support him. You know?
Stan, just one thing quickly, Stan. I don't know if you guys heard this. I was a statement made by the CEO of Eskom. Right, he says that we are paying too little for electricity.
Mm-hmm.
How are we paying too little for electricity? How are we doing that? We're struggling to buy electricity every single damn time.
Yes,
and yet they want to put it up at 32%, and then again they'll put it up again. Right, the same with the petrol. Same with diesel.
Yeah.
Why? Because we don't want to stand up and fight this injustice.
That's right.
We become too comfortable where we are.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And like you said, Stan, if we say something, then we become bad because people think we're just fighting with them. It's not fighting with people, man. It's about standing up for what you believe in. If you know that you've been taken for a ride, what are you going to do? Yeah. Sit down and just say, oh, it's all right. No, it's not all right.
Yeah.
How long are you going to say it's all right?
Yeah.
Right? And like I said to you, Stan, my old boss told me, he says, Wafik, if people do not complain about you, you're not doing your job. Mm-hmm. And I understand why he said that today.
Mm. You are so right by what you've mentioned. If we don't stand up, if we don't speak up, we're not going to have... You know what? We've been conditioned as well. We've been conditioned for the mere fact that we need to listen, we need to keep quiet. That is what I've told us over the years. You mustn't talk. You are colored, you are Indian, you are black, you should keep quiet. And I'm not talking about white people, I'm just talking about the infrastructure that is still here. The infrastructure, still, the conditioning of our minds that happened many years ago, it's still running through our generations. You know, the wealth has been taken from us. And I don't think people understand when we talk about, I get very upset. Because my family had property, they had housing. Mm. And we had to start over again. We now have to rebuild. And now BEE comes in. BEE makes it more difficult for us. Because it's another way of dividing us. I don't know how Preston and Jovan feels on this, but I mean, buying a house and, you know, starting from scratch nowadays is the most difficult thing. I mean, for me it was about 20 years ago. For you guys, I don't know, they started recently maybe. How do you guys feel about it? Because this younger generation is younger than you. I am afraid for my children. Will they be able to afford a house? Will they have a job in this climate?
And I think that's where the whole thing comes, where you have to start your own business. Mm. Four or five of them. Mm. Not just one.
Must have multiple streams.
Because you especially, in, and that's where our youth needs training. Because if they don't even know how to start one, do you know, it's important to know that, listen, you're not starting a business only because so that you can say, I'm a business owner. You're starting it to generate revenues or income for yourself and for your family to have a house to do it. And be taught these things, because the previous systems taught their kids to do this.
Yeah.
Whatever lighter skin, but all the white, black, that, they were taught to run businesses so that they could do multiple things through these businesses. Mm-hmm. Just before you, just check this stat, no? I want to show you, when it comes to small businesses, there's 68.8% of businesses in South Africa are small businesses.
Mm-hmm.
19.7% are medium-sized businesses. Yeah. 11.5% are large businesses. So the predominant amount of businesses are small and medium. Mm. The percentage of that employment is 23%. The 11.5% employs 77% of the people.
Sure.
That's the system, bro. Now you tell me. See, look here. See, almost 80% of it now is small business and small and medium businesses, and they only employ about 20% of the people. So the rest of the 80% is employed by the 11% large businesses. This is the system.
Yeah.
Now you tell me, how is that small business supposed to break that bar?
We see a lot of problem also. Maybe it's impossible. Like at this moment, it's impossible unless you can start with change. It will take many years, like Stan said earlier. But you see where a lot of small businesses is failing. Like Javon mentioned, you need to have multiple streams of income. Now, what people is not doing is they're not consistent.
Mm.
Our people is not consistent. So what happens is you earn, maybe you sell taxis on the side. Now you're getting an income. Maybe your profit is 2,000 a month. But now the only thing that you do is sell the tackies.
Mm-hmm.
So why not think, okay, cool, I'm getting a 2,000 year, let me try and do this on the side, and here's another 5 coming in. Now you've got 2 streams of income. Mm-hmm. Remember, the more consistent you're going to be with this, the more sales is going to increase. And start making yourself relevant, guys. We live in a digital era. If you're not going to do that, maybe a lot of men so much found gems at the moment. There's gems being thrown around here.
There's a system. Look, I'm not going to talk about other countries, but it is important to talk about these systems.
Yeah.
So I've been 24 years in the UAE, you know where the UAE is, United Arab Emirates. I've been in Ras Al Khaimah, Dubai, Abu Dhabi, Fujairah, Al Ain, all those places. Doesn't matter where, which emirate it is. It's the same concept that the Emiratis, this is their country.
Yeah.
They run the business.
Mm.
So there's no thing about race and no, it's Arabs. So basically, all of them, it's their country.
Yeah.
They run the business. They don't look at you like your color and what. No, you've got a business. Abdullah's got a business. Fahad's got a business. Khairi's got a business. That's it. That's their country. So you as a foreigner coming over there, you work for them.
Mm.
That's how the business works.
Yeah.
So we should have that year. Forget the color. That's what I say, economic apartheid. Forget the color, forget race and blah, blah, blah. Just think as South Africans, We are South Africans. Whether you look Chinese, whether you're black or whatever color you look. What does your passport say? I'm South African. Yes. Okay. Alhamdulillah, you're South Africans. So we make business.
Oh.
Mm-hmm. You understand?
But the system is still there because you must still think of current.
You must.
But
on the box, you must study whether you like it or not.
That is what I'm saying.
Yeah. I say, Adolf,
you can't say to me, like South African. Like when I went over there, they treated me like South African.
Mm-hmm.
Whether you're black or white. Or,
mm-hmm. There was two South Africans.
Two South Africans was working under me.
Mm.
How come? Mm. Two whiteys were working under me. I'm sorry to say whitey, but it's facts.
Yeah.
They didn't see it like that. They just saw that I'm the entertainment manager. I know my job.
Mm.
Those people know my quality.
Mm-hmm.
So they had to work under me.
Yeah.
So, which papers should I print now?
Yeah.
That papers. Why? They didn't look at the color. They look at, okay, you're all South Africans.
Your people, we all these people.
But that's the problem.
I've got the skills that they don't have.
Mm-hmm.
That's why they're working for me.
Yeah. But Uncle, that is
that's how it should be here.
We are Cape Townians. We're South Africans.
But you just be seeing
like you said now, why do we still have, in most of the applications built in this country, you must select white, black, Indian, colored, or other. Why can't you just select South African? Your ID should tell the people that you're South African. Why must you go and select a color? And remember, that color, we didn't say we are colored. Mm. It was given to us.
Given to us, yeah.
Exactly.
It was given to us. We didn't. That's our name. But you see, that is how the struggle still goes on. We're still being labeled because of the apartheid, the aftermath of apartheid.
There we go.
There's so many things in this country that people will not see. The structure is still here. This guy said something. He's a friend of mine. Very, 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 very powerful. Yeah. Lanil Adonis. I think we mean him.
Why don't they see? When I go to a shop, I used to be in Cross Park before I went to Musenberg.
Mm.
My wife always said me go to the shop around the corner. Now, before I used to go to a shop, and I was a Bobby man. You know, like...
Yeah,
Okay, I see Pakistan. No problem with that. Why don't you call them colors also?
Mm-mm.
Because they also color.
Yeah.
But now they look at them. So now I've got to make business with you. Maybe I've got fruit and veg.
Mm-mm.
I'm going to bring it to this shop,
mm-mm.
to this Pakistani.
Yeah.
I've got no problem with that. But if you at the shop, my brother from the same mother,
mm-mm.
I can make business with you and give you the fruit and vegetables.
Mm-mm.
You understand? But now you on the street and those people are making, these foreigners are making more money than you.
In your own land.
As a so-called color.
No.
They're making more money. Mm-hmm. The Ethiopians, the Pakistanis. They're making more money. Mm-hmm. If they go over there, they don't do that.
Mm-hmm.
You understand? They don't own the place. They don't.
Mm-hmm.
But we people suffer more than they suffer. Come on. You want to tell me the foreigners is more powerful than we as South Africa?
The citizens.
Yeah. So Marika de Klerk was the one that really brought this in.
Yeah,
made it.
De Klerk's wife.
Yeah, and this is what she said. Traditionally, colors have no history of nationhood.
Mm-hmm.
The definition of a color in a population to register is someone who's not black, not Indian, but also a non-person.
Mm-hmm.
Bro, you tell me I'm a non-person. And to this day, because of the system put in place, we're still taking oaths, non-person.
Yeah. Yeah. So you're following...
He's not. So
that
the
group is
to this day, we'll still embrace it when we take it off.
Yeah.
When will that end, is what you're saying?
Exactly.
And this point that the guy's bringing up here, this should go to parliament.
Of course.
This should be the next government should scrap that system.
Because if the apartheid economy is still there, we can see it because I'm a Celtic of color.
Mm-hmm.
There's no Kosa, there's no Zulu, there's all that. This, like
black,
just
yeah,
black.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
There should actually be
white.
Yeah. But there should actually be Kosa, Zulu, because they belong to a tribe.
Exactly.
You know, so should we also be, if you want to be
Khoisan
or whatever, you,
go, you
can do it.
You know what I mean? But how can I think of every time I'm a non-person? I mean, it sits with me, my brother. I'm like, no, I'm not a non-person.
Yeah,
Chavan, if you erase the history of the indigenous people of this province, you hide all the wrong that was done to the people back in the day.
Mm-hmm.
So our history is being erased, and we are allowing it because we are choosing colored. We are choosing to follow a system that is died out long already.
Yeah.
Sisters, listen to this quickly. And this is so true. Two people doing the same job at the same company, same age, one white, one colored. Colored guy can afford to buy a house. White guy can afford to buy a house on the Cape Flats.
Mm-hmm.
A white guy can buy a house, 2 million plus house in a nice area and drive a nice car. Because why? Like I said earlier on, the interest rates is less for them. So that system is still very much determining, will we leave money behind for our kids? Will we leave a financial legacy behind for our children? And that is what parliamentarians would fight for, is the equality of the living of our people in this country. They're just fighting for us. Giving us food, giving us clothing, telling stories, that does nothing to what we're facing. Our fight is against the inequalities of our people in the Cape Flats and all around the poverty-stricken areas.
Yeah.
Yes. One time we were playing pool, man, in the Movenpick in Dubai, in the heart of Dubai. This is like Dubai. Jumeirah Beach Hotel. Chilling out everything.
Lovely, man.
Playing pool. This Indian guy walks in. Indian. Mm. So everyone thinks it's Indian. And the manager, I don't know if it was South African, and he told him to sit there or don't put this in. And he kind of insulted him. You know, like, but why can't I sit there? So he thought it's Indian. The guy took out his passport. He was like, might. Know who I am? I'm British. I couldn't say anything to him. So he didn't look at the color. But see how they looked at him. But he could say, I'm British. And the British embassy will back him up. Can't they do this here with us? Forget the color.
Yeah.
Just say, hey, I'm South African. I'm South African, born and bred South African. My passport is South African. I can go all over the world with my South African passport, not with a colored passport, not with a white passport or a black or Chinese passport, South African passport. You don't label me anyway, only as a South African. And that's how I travel the world. You understand?
Mm.
That's the problem we have here.
I just want to give this over to Wafik. We was forgetting about Wafik. Wafik, I apologize, brother. It's getting hot in here. But this is what I
should be there.
This. Maybe you can take us on this one. We still have a few minutes left. But this is something that I spoke about over the weekend. Maybe white guys invest his money, colored guys as black tax. Yes. Remember, like I said, black tax is because of the forced removal. It has been because of the inequality in the economical system. My father can't retire because he's earned a little bit of money to survive. I need to look after him. My mother can't go to the hospital. I need to make now put her on my medical aid. It's things like that. The black tax, we still need to look after our parents. You know, I did what I could for my mother, but there's many other young people out there that is now still in the same situation. So black tax is one of the things that is, I want to say, that comes from, or colored tax comes from, the forced removal, because the problem that government caused is now our problem. Wafik, over to you. Maybe you can just say some light on that for us.
Okay. Let's first ask the question, right? When the Group Areas Act happened, right? Who got most of those housings? It's the white people. in the rich areas. That's who got all those houses. Now, if you look at it, right, those same properties in the book cop and stuff, and in town and stuff, who's it being sold to? It's to outsiders. I don't know if I can say it, but it's been sold to Jews, not to South Africans, not to Cape Townians. Why? Because we cannot afford that amount of money. And where is all that money going to? It's not going to anything else, but it's going to a specific group. A specific group, where that's where the money goes to, and it stays there. You know, and you're so right. You know what? We cannot leave legacies behind because we don't have that financial freedom. We don't have that financial freedom. The big people, the big bosses stay the big bosses. And we all know who they are, unfortunately. I mean, why do we have to do five businesses? Well, because one business is not enough for us. But that one person that started his business 40 years ago can still manage to keep his generations after him. But we can't do that. We have to work 2-3 jobs just to keep the lights burning. And it's unfair. Why? Because we didn't get that opportunity those people got. And people will say, yes, stop blaming that and work towards it. But if it stems from something, how do we put... We can't get it right now because it's just gone. How can I put it? It's just gone worse at the moment. It's worse. We are worse off than what we were before. So how do we get over this, right? By standing together, I'm going to bring it again. By standing together, and fighting the injustice that happened to us previously. Right? If we do not fight this injustice, in 5 years from now, we're going to be sitting here and saying the same thing over and over. We need to put a stop to it. We need to put a stop to the projects that happen in our area and people only taking 5 laborers from us. I mean, like I said, the project is worth 17, 18 million rand. If you're taking 5 laborers, right, it's going to cost you less than 100,000. Right? If we, how can we put it? If we do the roads, right, it's probably costing them about 2 million rand, 3 million rand, if I might, to resurface the roads. And I've made this comment before. They resurfaced St. Remo. They've resurfaced Bayview. If you guys ever drive into these areas, the resurfacing of the roads were done crap. But they spent millions to do it. Right? These people are still complaining that the stones are loose, right? And when it's too hot, the tar actually melts and it sits on your tires, right? So coming back to the project of the resurfacing of the roads. So if you look at it, 3 million rand, 100,000, where's the rest of the money going to? Why can't they use that same money, save the same money, and build us a double carriageway? Huh? Wouldn't that be better for us?
That's a very interesting question that you are touching on there. Where is the money going? I think that's the first question we should ask ourselves. The reason why we are not being included in these contracts, remember, if we have money, we have independence. If we have independence, we can claim back what was stolen from us. And I think that is the thing here. Look at the bigger picture. And this is not a conspiracy theory. You know what is happening? Our people are being said, okay, you're going to get your properties back. But our mothers and fathers are dying because they're taking their time, and we're forgetting about it, and they want to keep us there. But our people need to wake up, Wafik. We need to realize that the money is not the issue. Jesse said something here. Let me just... This is powerful. Jesse, this is one thing I agree with you. For the whole night, this is what I agree with you. It's not just the land they stole from us. They left a lot of our people uneducated. That's one of the biggest crimes. That's the infrastructure we still have here. Wafik, you only have one high school in this area, but there's quite a few thousand youngsters that are living here. You only have two primary schools here, but our children go in other areas. So what's happening is, right, we are being stranded because if people are not held, don't have knowledge, they stay where they are. And they have been keeping us dumb because they're not building. We had the ward councillor, you were here last week or 2 weeks ago, the ward councillor said, and this is what he said, I asked him, why aren't we building schools? He said, it's a national government thing. Now, okay, then I'm going to vote for a national government to come and take over the Western Cape because national government is going to build schools. We need to stop playing these games. Our people need education, we need more schools. Our people need to be educated, you know. And I agree with Jesse. They stole that from us. Many of our parents today can't read and write, 50, 60 years old, 70 years old, because of a system that has kept us, you know, in poverty, that has kept us, you know.
Stan, I don't know if you know this, but at the back, I live in St. Remo, guys, by the way. So at the back, where Caltech's side, if you come past Caltech's, that side was actually earmarked for a school. That was many years ago, right? Unfortunately, that didn't materialize, right? So now it's earmarked for housing. And I'm going to say this here, the lady that's responsible for it, she's the leader of the Good Party. So that land at the back here by us was a private developer many years ago, right? Took money from the people and obviously ran away or went into jail now and whatever. So Patricia DeLille got a hold of that land. And what did she decide to do? Is to dump more housing here, right? Now, I'm coming back to the road surfacing, right? They're going to do that road surfacing, right? There's a college coming, not in the future now, right? There's housing, more housing coming. What's going to happen to our traffic down Spine Road and Old Stramfontein Road, early hours of the morning? What is going to happen to us? We were looking at economical growth, right? Yes, people say college is good, but what about businesses springing up, right? We need more businesses. We need more business hubs around us, right? I mean, for us to go, in Stramfontein at the moment, our nearest shopping center would be a Westgate Mall, right? That's built up, right? I'm talking about a good shopping center. That's the only one you can go to. Oh, Promenade. How many people really actually go to Promenade, right? So instead of building these houses and stuff, what about an economical hub where people can get jobs in our own economy, in our own surroundings? Build up our economy, like Bishop's Court is built up, like Newlands is built up, like Claremont is built up. Why can't we have the same here? Why must we always fight for what we want? They say there's no money, right? The city tell us, no, there's no money for this, there's no money for that. But 17 million rand on a resurfacing of a road. Come on, who are they lying to? Huh? And the councillor says they only get a million rand budget, right? How much budget does these other areas get? Bishop's Court, Newlands, Claremont, Constantia. What is their budget? The annual budget for revamps and parks and all that. What is their budget? How is it that Cape Flats only get a million rand budget?
Can I just say something? I understand exactly what you're saying. But you see, if we're all going to talk about why and what and how, is we're never going to find a solution for it. So we need to find a solution for abolishing those things happening right now.
The system.
We need to find a way of getting through to it where we can abolish this once and for all. Because we all have stories. I have also a story because I was born in District 6. I left 10 years old, I went and I was happy because we're going to Mitchell's Plain, nice place. And it was a sand. But I come from there, you know, our families have businesses in Hanover Street. Where's the business there to go to Gatesville? I can also say, why? Because we forget that. We need to find a solution to this problem. And I said again, the apartheid in the economics. So it doesn't matter which places we talk about, and about us, we need to talk about South Africa now. How are we going to find a solution to this problem where we get away from the economic apartheid and start building on South Africans uniting and having that economic business booming? That's what we need at the moment. Not about colors, not about whites, not about black. South Africans come together, unite, and let the business boom. Then we will have success. We can't have success with this one is more beautiful than the other one, or more ugly than the other one, because that's a, more ugly get more jobs nowadays. Yeah, you know.
I'm going to give the two gentlemen. Now, I just want to leave something with you. Remember, many of the areas on the Cape Flats is not conducive to have businesses. For the mere fact that you have gang violence that's out of control. We have these gangsters that is, asking of people for money, protection money. So many, and in some areas, you can't open even a normal shop in Ottery. You can't open the shops there because the winkels, the buildings that are there is between the gangsters. So any time they start shooting in other areas as well. So you see also what has happened is it has been set up, the structure, infrastructure of the Cape Flats has been set up for us not to be business people. And that's why businesses don't actually really work out. Strandfontein,
true.
I've come here. I've been here. I've come from 1999. The mense support is die keekies, honey. Hoe gaan hulle nog die winkel support? That is unfortunately our mindsets. People drive out of the community to go to Canal or wherever, but we don't support the local businesses. And that is unfortunately our mindsets. We are setting ourselves up for failure as well. What are we doing? You know, yes, we can have this conversation every Monday, but what structures are we putting in place to help our people? I'm going to give over to the two young men here. I'll let you all walk in Seagull.
You must get a store in Canal Walk for your neighbor to buy by you.
Oh, you must get a store in Canal Walk for your neighbor to buy by you.
That's literally.
But yes, literally.
But I think it's all working. I think Joshua mentioned this. He said it's time that, that as soon as he read it out, he said it's time that our young people get involved in politics so that we can take government. And I think that's important because this generation has a different mindset. I mean,
yes.
Emil also mentioned, he mentioned that our people need healing educationally. There's something that needs to change and it needs to be from, and we don't need to go to a school to be able to do that. We can do that in our communities.
Yeah.
And that's what we're starting to do.
And yeah, that's what we're starting to
do. We're doing certain initiatives so that we can go to schools and educate the on politics. It's not a politics is not your it's actually government. It's actually governance. Politics is not the party, the PA, the NC, all of these things that come in so they can get you vote because they go on for their own agenda. Governance is ruling. How are you ruling? Because those parties are puppets. Who's actually ruling government? This is where the whole economy
comes. Now this is the thing. I like what you're saying, ruling the government. And I always say this at my wife also. Us. He can't make changes because we are the majority.
Yeah.
So the same thing, you have the political party, they're only a party. But we as a people, we are the power. But it doesn't look like it.
Yeah.
Because the people, they don't think like that. They just think, no water. No, we have the power to fight. Hey, what's happening? What's happening? Hey, we're not happy with that. The people don't realize that. How I know that? Because when we, that forced removal, we went to Richardson, I started first. My father didn't. finished school. I went to matric. You know what? Studied thanks to him, thanks to my mother.
Mm.
Understood. I was in the SRC. But my father went to work. Hey, but we are boy, now a boycott yellow. You got big. Said, no, but you must be part of the struggle. No, I got my work.
Mm.
So he didn't understand. He just went. The same thing when we were removed from District 6. I was young. I didn't understand. I just nice that. But my father was just, okay. He accepted it.
Yeah.
And I was angry with him.
Mm-hmm.
For 5 years, I was angry with him.
Mm-hmm.
You understand?
Mm-hmm.
Because I grew up
mm-hmm.
and I understood. But then he said, I didn't understand.
Mm.
Sure. He just got to go. Okay, we just play. Achatos. Yeah. I'm the happy one, and he's just the one who
said,
with that
mm.
No, man. That's why I say we people must stand up. Mm. It's by time when people stand up. Because I'm telling you, most of our people here, why they don't? Because they think, no, just listen to what ANC say. Just listen to what DA say. Just listen to what. Don't listen to what they say. Don't disagree. Ask, hey, listen, or don't even ask to say,
mm-mm.
We don't like this.
Yeah.
Who's got the power to say that? We have the power. Who put the constitution in order? Mm-hmm. Us.
Yeah.
We decide. Not they. They can't come and say, okay, this and that and that.
Yeah.
They must ask us.
But change starts with you as an individual.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So we're going to be speaking about it, but we're not playing it out personally. And we're not playing it out
yes.
every day and living by what you speak.
That's right.
Yeah.
And you're an hypocrite.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly.
So something small that I've adapted, like I can see where the youngsters are eating because like I see them walking past and it's disgraceful, you know,
mm-hmm.
coming to front with their line.
Mm-hmm.
Can't blame the school. Your discipline starts at home. But
that's right.
The kids are walking past and it's bad.
Mm-hmm.
Like, the language and how they're performing
mm-hmm.
and how they're conducting themselves. With the school uniform, you're supposed to feel proud. You said then wearing blazers when back in the day we didn't have blazers.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just thinking about it now.
Yeah,
your
yeah,
guys
yeah,
used
yeah.
to have blazers. You saw yo. But anyway,
mm-hmm.
so what I started doing is I started like between a group of kids.
Mm-hmm.
If I see potential in a lighting, I will then drop a gem every day on that child.
Yes.
And I actually got one of the kids in as an apprentice from, I think it was grade 10,
mm.
and he's heading to matric next year.
Mm.
And I can see how his mindset changed compared to the other kids that's walking past, because I'm constantly
mm.
nurturing it and giving him gems, dropping
yeah.
him gems, and giving him motivation, and showing him that there is a different way to think. You don't just have to think, hey, I need to go to work 9 to 5, 9 to 5. Hey, bro, to go to town, guys, you're going to sit in 2 hours of traffic of your day.
Mm.
So you only have 22 hours left of the day to do something. That's a system that was designed.
Mm.
So you see, the thing for me is, and I like, and I like what you say. Let's say you're a father, he's a father, he's a father, and you've got your kids.
Mm.
But now you know how to you know how to nurture, you guide and protect.
Mm.
But he doesn't, right? But you do. He doesn't. Only you. But now, how is he gonna nurture his kid and guide and protect through you? Now he needs you. He needs you. Now it's three.
Mm.
Isn't that more powerful?
Mm.
More powerful. Because mm-hmm. you're doing it alone. You guide and protect your kid. His kid. No. So his kid will go wrong. Maybe your kid is going to be with him and da da da. But now if you get together, then all those kids will have that same understanding. So that means it comes from us also. So let's say the four of us, now 10 of us
mm.
will make a difference.
Mm.
The four of us can already make a difference. 10 more,
no.
1,000. 1,000 out of 5,000.
Yeah.
Make a big difference.
And that's the reason why Javon is doing what he's doing. Or let's say us, we're all doing what we're doing.
Yeah.
It's because we are trying to get a network
mm.
of people together.
Yeah.
That thinks differently.
Mm.
Everyone's on the same track so that you can start making change strategically. You need to make change strategically and targeting the drugs on the street. Like I'm talking about, like the addicts. The addicts is walking lost souls. They are all our neighbors. So if I made it my duty, when I see you, you might think that I'm irritating you, but I'm constantly going to massage you over my throat. When you're going to be ready, you know that. Because I calculated how much this one guy, he told me that he's smoking for 15 years. We done a rough estimation of how much he spent so far. The drug could have bought him a joint of over a mil. He could have had a car. He could have probably put his lighties through studies with all the money he spent. It was way over a mil.
But now there's a thing. That's where the education comes in about finance. If you know the saying, give a man fish, he live for the day. If you teach him how to fish, he don't need you anymore. So once you have that concept in your mind, then you start knowing how to save.
Yeah.
But not only us, all over the world, Americans also, hey man, drinks on me, man, here's my car. Put on me, they lose his job. Where's the money? He didn't save, he didn't know anything about financial planning. So those are all the kind of things that we need to discuss with, you know. But like I said, we can do all those things. It's fine. But we need that economic, and I said again, the apartheid in economics must be changed.
That's right.
Correct. Because it's not just, we're gonna do it. Yes, it's fine. Let's do it. Put the action there. Let's get together. I change this. This is my most important focus for South Africa. Because at the moment, yes, we're gonna do good. We're gonna help our communities, but that is not the end game. That's not the end game.
But we have to start somewhere. We're gonna start focusing on the big picture alone.
So this is what I'm saying. So this is what I'm saying. While we do those things, you know, you focus on that, but don't forget the bigger picture. So while we're doing this, we're training this and we're talking about this and we're putting our thing in order, and now we are prospering. It doesn't mean we are prospering now, okay? The same thing like I said about load shedding. Yeah, okay, so it's load shedding. That was kind of generated. Like as a right point to generate. You know? So the same thing like I'm saying, push for this envelope, let it succeed, but don't forget the national move. Because sometimes we can forget, like we are successful here. En dan begint het van tijd, als er weer nog een COVID is, al lang was weer, en het was een probleem weer, you know.
Right, what you say is right, and your work, basically our work is never going to stop. Like our work is never going to stop, because we need to make sure that the generations to come, my kids, my grandkids, their children, is going to be sorted.
Yes.
So we also need to start to know how to compound, guys. It's very important.
Yeah.
If you want to know what compounding is, guys, there's lots of videos on YouTube. You can check it out.
Yeah. Gentlemen, we have spoken a lot for an hour and 15 minutes. We must give over to each and everyone just to say something small, not longer than a minute. Like I said, we spoke a lot. This is a conversation you can't have. You know, we're going to continue it next week. If there's anybody in the audience, I always invite you. If you want to come, join us. Come into the studio. Join us. Be part of the conversation. You know, the movement is not linked to any political party. The movement is not linked to any color or race. The movement is us, the people, that are fed up of what's happening. We are the people in charge. We have the power to change things. And we need to use that power to start standing up. There's no funny way anymore. That's your funnige way van dinge change. We need to do it the right way. They've tried 1994 to fix things quickly. Look where we're sitting at. It's going to take time to fix things, but we have time. We're still young. So I'm going to give over to Wafik. Wafik, just any last words from you that you want to leave with us?
Okay. Stan, all I can say is that if we stand together, we can definitely achieve a lot. But if we're gonna do it individually, it's not gonna work. A lot of people making a noise, it gets heard. So as a community, we need to stand together.
We're having the closing now.
Yeah, so it's just, you know, just something a little hot, maybe.
I'm unmuted.
So you're unmuted, so you have to explain yourself over again.
No, man. Guys, all I can say is, guys, be blessed. I'm not going to read what I said. If you missed it, you missed it. as long as the guys are serious. But just be blessed, guys, man. And start focusing on solutions and not problems. Because if you're going to continuously focus on the problems, it's going to weigh you down, maybe. Start speaking things into existence. It's what I can say. Speak things into existence is going to happen. Believe in yourself. You're capable of a lot, maybe. Javon?
I think our responsibility is to the next generation. And I think if you're a parent, I think if you're a grandparent, I think it's a responsibility to say, you know what, listen, I'm actually going to take some time out and I'm going to spend some time speaking to my kid about politics, the importance of it. Because if we don't do that, in 20 years' time, when a generation has passed, where are we going to be as a people? And I think that's important that we take the time, educate the kids, educate the people around us and say, you know, it's going to take a while. Like, some people don't want to be in politics. They don't want to get involved in it simply because of all this corruption. And there's nobody that's standing up that you can say is a person of integrity. Is very, very rare that you find in somebody like that. And I think it's where we say, you know what, hey, God, get involved. See where you can get involved. I mean, just look at the current parties that's there, whatever it else. But, you know, look in your community, see where we can build. And let's do it. Because in 20 years' time, we don't know what this country will be like if we don't take a stand now. I've taken it upon myself, like personally, where I realize we are the generation that's laying the foundation. We might not see the hundreds of billions and all that stuff and all of that, but our children and our grandchildren are going to be the ones that's going to bear the fruit of what we do now. So I think as a generation, we need to start doing it now. That's from my side. Thanks.
No, that's awesome.
Yeah, I was going to say something that is said now, and I'm wafik about communities and generation to generation. True story, logical, everyone cannot argue me on this one. When you're alone, you're alone.
Yeah.
You find a woman, boom, bam, bam, you get married. You get married, family starts, right? Then you've got kids, right? Family grows bigger. Those kids, they make kids, they make babies. Yeah. You become a grandfather, a great grandfather, but it's still there. So that family start building, and they start creating communities. That communities, you have cities.
Mm.
And from that cities, you have an empire. That's a true story. So from one family, you can have quite a few. So imagine if everyone thinks like that.
Sure.
How much powerful are we? So exactly what he's saying, generation to generation, that's generational. So if we can think like that, and start building communities, A for the way. That's it.
Awesome. Also, I just want to add something as I end off, as I conclude this conversation. It was very interesting.
Mm.
I think we spoke, you know, like we would speak outside. Yeah. But these gentlemen are also joining Cape Fritz Radio. They're also going to be presenters on Cape Fritz Radio Station. Uncle Abu, all of them. So the nice thing is this. I'm just waiting for Wafik to tell me when he's going to join. If you want to be a radio presenter? If he says yes,
then I'm in anytime. Anytime, put me in there.
So the conversations will continue. They will have it on their platforms. They will have businesses. There's other things that they're planning. I think we need to become conscious about these things happening in our communities. And we need to be like papagayo. What's a papagayo? And I'm African, I'm English. Papagayo, repeating the things over and over. Because you know what? We forget about these things. We forget about what we said tonight. Tomorrow night, we will move on. We will have a different topic. This is not the topic where you will have 10,000 people viewing. Just go quickly to Mellenburg where a guy runs with a gun. 6,000 people live, you know. But when we speak about the things that changes communities,
yeah,
that is what we don't want to speak about. So I'm going to leave with you. We will be back next week on Monday. Jesse, message me. We can have you in the studio. Anybody else that want to join us? Maybe we should try and put up a camera or something. A camera would be nice. Then we can see, we sit like this, and then we can have the conversation. We will continue this on the platform as well, radio station as well. I am looking over to moving over to TikTok as well. We have quite a few followers on TikTok and Instagram. The message must get out there. We need to start speaking the truth, and the truth will set us free. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much. It was another episode of Apartheid Economy, or the first episode. We will have another one next week. Please do join us and enjoy what is left of Monday night. Cheers, yeah, ladies and gentlemen. Bye. Thanks,
guys.
See you, Wafik. Yeah. Cheers.
Okay, cool. Yeah.